Welcome back. In this video, we're going to take a closer look at price earnings and value earnings ratio. First, let's recall how do we compute PE or price earnings ratio. PE ratio is defined as price per share divided by earnings per share. Let's assume that a company will pay out 100% of its dividend. And you'll also not sell any new stock and you will have no stock repurchase. The company further on will maintain a constant debt to equity ratio. And you also have a constant return to equity. So these are very limited and restrictive assumptions, but it makes the demonstration a lot easier. Relaxing this assumption will just make the calculation a little bit more complicated, but it does not change the overall conclusion. So the conclusion will be a little bit more complicated, but the essence does not change. So we use this simple assumption to help us see the relationship between the PE ratio and the value earnings ratio. If we assume all this is correct, so a firm pay everything out, there will be no new equity and everything else is constant, then earnings will stay constant forever. Because you're paying out all your dividends, so earnings equals to dividend, you're not issuing new equity, you're not keeping any retained earning, you're having a constant debt to equity ratio, that means you have no new investment in the firm. So this is a no growth firm. You're paying everything out. And so the value of a no growth firm is a perpetuity. So the value is the earnings per share divided by the required return. So this is a perpetuity formula. And if you use dividends, it's the same because we're paying out all our earnings. So the value of the firm using either the cash flow, the earnings approach or the dividends approach will give you the same answer. So the value earnings ratio is the value per share divided by earnings per share, which is the inverse of this. So the value earnings ratio is just 1 over the cost of equity. And the difference between the price per share and earnings per share, so if you subtract the value per share of a no growth firm from the price, the current market price, the difference represents the present value of growth opportunity. So if the market price, if we assume the market price is correct and the market is sufficient, then the difference between these two represents the value that the market assigns to the growth opportunity of the firm. So this simple no growth firm gives us a very easy way to understand the relationship between value and price. Now let's extend our model to incorporate growth. So the value earnings ratio, let's assume that earning can grow, but we'll assume that you'll grow at a constant rate forever. So once again, if the growth rate is different for a few years and then becomes constant, we just have the three parts, right? We'll have the forecast horizon part and then a continuing value part, but the essence remain the same. So we're going to just assume this is a growing perpetuity. And all growth arises from reinvesting its earnings. So this is the other extreme case. So we go from paying 100% dividend out, 100% earnings out as dividend to paying no dividend. So we're going to assume zero dividend. So indeed, and we further assume that the ROE is equal to the cost of equity. So this is zero residual ROE, zero residual income. So in this case, we can easily forecast earnings per share. So earnings per share will increase at this constant growth rate. So we can estimate earnings per share at any point in time. And the value per share is a growing perpetuity. So you'll be next year's year one's earnings per share, which is defined as earnings per share in year zero times one plus the constant growth rate, divided by the required return minus the growth rate. And the value earnings ratio, so if you take the value divided by earnings per share, So we're dividing earnings per share into here. So earnings per share will cancel out. And what is remaining is 1 plus the growth rate divided by the required return minus the growth rate. So this is the, and that's how we come up with the price earnings growth ratio. And once again, we take the next year's expected earnings per share, so price divided by earnings, and we divide that by the growth rate times 100. As you can see, the PE ratio and the value to earnings ratios are very easy to compute and very easy to apply. More important is the drawbacks and the special consideration you want to take into account when you apply it. So let's take a look at what we need to watch out for. First of all, the PE ratios are calculated as the current share price divided by historic earnings. Even though ideally, what we really want is to use the forecast earning because this is a misalignment of valuation. Our value should be based on future return to stockholders, not historic returns. So if you buy the stock today, how much the firm earned last quarter or last year has you already miss out. That won't be relevant for you as the new investor. So we really should be using forward-looking earnings. If we take the 4 PE ratio, and for that to do that, you need to use future earnings. And sometimes you may use analyst forecasts, but that is that using future earnings, so forecast of future earnings, that value of these earnings are very difficult to verify. So that gives you the that's a potential downside. And as we said, the reliability of this forward PE ratio depends on the earnings forecast. And if the earnings forecast is incorrect, which by definition, no one can predict the future, so there will always be some error in embedded in any forecast. And that will make a forward-looking PE ratio less reliable. Let's take a look at what can those error come from, and where can those errors come from, and how it may affect PE ratio. So when we use historic earning, we have a verifiable earning. So that value, the value for historic earning has been audited and is a much more reliable number, but it has also problems because if you when you're using historic growth rate, the simple PE ratio don't take into account growth. And for a firm, remember firm can be at different stage. If a firm is at an exponential growth stage then, or a temporary decline, either way, the past earnings are not a good forecast for the permanent long term. So when the current earnings is a transitory event, either exponential growth or temporary decline, that means make the earning PE ratio not a reliable measure. And then finally, because of the assumptions that we have seen made, if we assume that growth only comes from reinvested earnings, then the dividend policy can affect a firm's price. And of course, depending on the company's willingness to raise funds in other means, dividend payout ratio, the dividend policy, or the dividends payout ratio, may or may not have a strong impact on a firm's price. So with all this drawback, why do we use market-based ratios? And the reason is because this is not just because it's easy to use, it's also very valuable when we are trying to come up with values for firms that are not publicly traded. So we can use it as a benchmark to compare valuation for other companies, particularly privately traded companies, because privately held firms that don't have stock that are traded are very difficult to value. PE ratio is also one of the most watched and most used ratio. So it has a lot of use, not just by private firm, but also by investment bankers. So IPO, initial public offering, is when a private firm sells its shares to the public for the first time. So once again, a market-based ratio can be useful. Of course, we need to take that to be very careful. If a firm has different debt ratio, has different systematic risk, we need to make sure that we adjust for that appropriately. The downside is that there is no scientific way or precise way to adjust this PE ratio, because both the growth and risk are combined together in this multiple. So let's take a look at what may cause the PE ratio to be different across different firms, so that we may when we try to adjust a PE ratio for an appropriate firm, we can take that into account. The primary drivers are the three things: risk, profitability, and growth. In addition, PE ratio can also be caused by differences in accounting methods and principles, including quality of earnings, and also the degree to which discretionary accounting policies are used, including depreciation policies and reserves. In general, you can expect a riskier firm to have a lower PE ratio. So this is the profitability and risk. Then the profitability can also be measured as the difference between ROE and cost of equity. So the higher the ROE relative to cost of equity, the higher will be the PE ratio. And because that we don't want the PE ratio to fluctuate greatly from year to year, a lot of analysts, instead of using a single period earning, they will use a running average, so that a single quarter or single year earning deviation will not greatly impact a firm's PE ratio. Let's take a look at what researcher has found. Researchers find that most of the differences, so the variability, differences in PE ratios across different firms, can be attributed to risk and growth. Perman in his study showed that the future residual income is much higher for higher market to book firms than for lower market to book firm. So again, higher market to book represents higher growth, and residual income is a measure of growth. Here is the results summarized. This is a paper published in Journal of Accounting and Research from 1996. Is a classic paper, so these results has been consistent and is widely accepted. So we see that high PE ratio firms tend to have current period residual income that is much lower than future residual income. So what that means is the PE ratio for these firms are temporarily high because residual income is temporarily low. In contrast, firms that has low PE ratio tend to have current residual income that are greater than future residual income, suggesting these firms are experiencing low PE ratios because residual income is temporarily high. So this gives us an intuition that when market to book ratio should be high, low, or normal, and concurrently, when the PE ratio should be high, low, or normal. And now you know how to compute the market multiples and also the valuation multiples. So what do we do when the value that you come up with, your valuation, is different from the market? it doesn't mean that your calculation is wrong or the market is wrong. The first thing that we want to do is to learn more about why. Why are they different? So what we want to do is check our assumptions versus the market's assumptions. We don't know what the market's assumptions are, so we'll have to reverse engineer to figure out the assumption that is implied in the current stock price. If you find that the implied assumption by the market is too optimistic, then you can conclude that the stock may be overpriced. So instead of just relying on your value, you can look at your assumption versus the market's assumption to say, which one is more realistic? Is my assumption more realistic or is the market's assumption more realistic? If you conclude that your assumption is more realistic and the market is too optimistic, then the stock is overpriced and you would not want to invest in that stock. On the other hand, if you find that the market is being too pessimistic and your own assumptions are more realistic, the stock may be underpriced and you'll make it a good investment. Let's take a look at how we can do this reverse engineering. We're going to use the stick and shake model. So pause the video and pull up the spreadsheet that you have already completed earlier. Okay. I want to point out one very important thing. Remember that one of the assumptions we make is the long-term growth rate. And we said this is one of the important assumptions. So in the model, it's not obvious. The earnings for year 11 is a formula. It's computed as the previous earning times 1 plus the growth rate. So this is your forecast horizon for 10 years. Starting in year 11, we assume that earnings will grow at a long-term growth rate of 3%. Remember that the market price is 309.98 million and our estimated value is 494.08 million. Let's assume that the cost of equity is correct. We can only challenge one assumption at a time. But we wanted to know what growth rate does the market assume to come up with a price of $309.98. Now you can solve this through algebra, but you can also use Excel, which is a very powerful has a very powerful tool to help us do reverse engineering. Want to emphasize that it's important that your model is all linked through equations. So we know that everything in our model are set up as formulas. I want the only one exception that this is mixing the model and the assumption area. This is the assumption area. This is part of our model that future growth rate, earnings, net income in year 11 is computed based on the growth rate. All right, so now we are ready to use Excel to help us quote unquote reverse engineer. Remember what our goal is. We want to find out what value of growth rate did the market assume to come up with a value of 309.98 million. The tool we're going to use is under data, what if analysis, go seek. So what we want to do is to set the value. Remember, this is our model that we created. We estimated the firm's value. We want to set the value to be the same as the market. So the market is 309.98 million. By changing the growth rate, so this B3 is where we're allocating our growth rate. So what we are saying is we're asking Excel to come up with a growth rate such that our market value will be our firm value will be the same as the market. So once you press OK, Excel will do that for you. Now, before I ask Excel to do that, let's do this manually. Okay, so let's take it one step back. I'm going to collapse some rows so that we can see the effect on. Actually, we can do this. We can freeze the rows and columns. So now you can see the value. Again, if I highlight this, it will make it easier for us to see what we are looking for. So this is the value. This is our assumption. So we know that a lower growth rate will reduce the value. So let's say if our growth rate is 2%, what about if growth rate is 1%? So we can see that the value is going down. What about growth rate is 0%? That still does not go down to the market value. So what about if we make growth rate to be minus 5%? Now our value is closer to the market. What about minus 10%? We are getting there. So the market is assuming that the growth rate is even worse than minus 10%. So we can do the trial and error like I did until you find the growth rate that makes the value equal to the market. Or we can use data, what if analysis, go seek, and have Excel find that for us much faster. So what we want is to make this number go to 309.98. So we want the value to be the same as the market by changing the growth rate. So you select OK. And GoSeek said they find a solution. So what this tells us is that the implicit growth rate that Excel assume is the implicit growth rate that the market assume is negative 14.646%. So stick and shake may be in a decline, but is it going to decline minus 14%? If you believe that that assumption is too pessimistic, then your conclusion will be that the firm is currently undervalued. And even though you use a growth rate estimate of 3%, you can even revise your growth rate downward to be more realistic. But the market growth rate of negative 14% seems overly pessimistic. We'll conclude this video here. When we come back, we're going to take a look at what researchers have found about market efficiency, and also how well does market multiples work as a valuation tool. See you soon.